This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Today, we have Jacques Vallee and Paola Harris on Dreamland discussing a book called Trinity, The Best Kept Secret. Christopher Mellon, now much in the news, the former Deputy Assistant Secretary of Defense for Intelligence under Bill Clinton and George W. Bush, says, thanks to the quiet, meticulous research of Dr. Vallee and Paola Harris, there is a fresh reason to believe that our government is concealing physical proof of alien technology. Read the book, and if persuaded, join the millions of other Americans seeking a straight answer. And people who think, Christopher Mellon already must know the answer. I know Christopher Mellon well enough as an acquaintance, he's not a friend, to know that's not the case, and it should be. Paul Hellyer, the former Minister of National Defense for Canada, said, this is the story of an earlier event in 1945 that remains even more significant today. Paola Harris and Jacques Vallee have spent much effort doing field research on location in San Antonio, New Mexico, not Texas. It is now time that their discovery be revealed to the world. Now, this is quite an extraordinary achievement on the part of both of you, and I might add that Paola and Jacques need no introduction to most Dreamlanders, but I'm going to introduce you anyway. Paola Harris is a longtime UFO researcher. She has been researching this field, and I'm not going to ask you how long, Paola, but suffice to say, folks, it's long. And the same is true of Jacques.
You can ask me. It's 40 years.
40 years.
40 years.
I first met Jacques Vallee in 1988 and found in him first an exceptional and open mind, and second, a high level of intelligence and ability to look into these mysterious questions in an entirely new way. I believe that Jacques' book, Passport to Magonia, which I have read dozens of times and use as a reference text, is a really groundbreaking book. It certainly was in my life. I can remember when Ann Strieber was heard about it at a UFO group, and all of the people were saying, we don't want to read that. It's about fairies, and saying that the aliens are really fairies. As soon as we left, we went marching down to the nearest bookstore and bought it. And we both read it thoroughly, because this whole experience is not what we think. And this book will illustrate that beautifully. Trinity is a book about a very strange event. And that's how we're going to look at it today on Dreamland. Welcome to both of you. And I'm so pleased and proud to have you with me today.
Thank you, Whitley. It's a pleasure.
Well, good. And Paola, it hasn't been on Dreamland since 2009. And so I'm very glad to have you back as well.
It's a pleasure for me also, and it's been a very great experience working with Jacques on this book, because I think the book is going to make a difference, Whitley.
I hope so, Paola. If I've seen all of the carping about it on the internet, and folks, just forget that and read this book. It's not in any way what is being claimed about it. It is an excellent job of research about something an awful lot of people in the UFO community would like not to believe, because they didn't discover it, I think. But Paola, let's get started with your first inkling. When did you first hear about this story? And then we're going to ask what exactly the story was. Can you tell us when you first heard about the story?
As you know, I lived in Italy from 1992 to 2007 when I came back to live in the United States. Well, I had read about it in 2005 in a Socorro journal. I was in Italy. I was reading that these two little, and they called them Indian boys at the time, and they're not Indian boys, they're Hispanic, had witnessed a UFO crash and a complete recovery. So, and it also added that they were still alive. So my first thought was, why aren't my colleagues on this? Like, this is an amazing story when the witnesses are still alive, and even though they were children then, I'm sure they have excellent memories. And as destiny would have it, it wasn't until 2009 when I was here in Colorado that the son of the pilot that did part of the retrieval called me, and he gave me the telephone number of what we know as the seven-year-old, Remy Baca. So I had, it took me 4 months to get Remy Baca's confidence on the phone, and he introduced me to the nine-year-old, Jose Padilla. I have Remy Baca since passed away, so it's a good thing I got to him because I was able to fly to Gig Harbor, Washington, have him filmed and also get his testimony. So I was in Italy when this all started, and destiny had it that, you know, I started working on it around 2009, 2010, and then Jacques came aboard for the last 4 years.
And why did you come aboard, Jacques?
Well, As you know, I mean, you've known my work for a long time. I have not spent a lot of time on UFO crashes. I've heard the stories. I've cataloged the stories. I've tried to make sense out of them. But I've been accused of neglecting those stories, and to a great extent, I'm guilty. I'm guilty because when I used to bring that up with Dr. Hynek or with others, we would compare notes, and there wasn't much that, you know, as scientists, that we could do. The witnesses were often anonymous. The army had taken everything away. There were reports of minerals and so on, but we could never really get our hands on it and test it. So I spent my time on other things, but I was always aware of that problem. I had been reintroduced to it by my friend Ron Brinkley, who was from New Mexico. His family had a long, long, long history there. And we looked at a couple of sites, especially the site that Diana, Pastulka has mentioned. We had even started digging at another site. And then he became aware of this particular case in San Antonio, New Mexico. And then, unfortunately, Ron was in a terrible, terrible accident and died. And then it's then that I became interested in pursuing the case, because there was the chance of getting some evidence. The witnesses, whether the names of witnesses were known, thanks to Paola. So Paola and I then started joining forces, and I came into the case thanks to her. Met Mr. Padilla, who was had been the nine-year-old at the site back in 1945, and the case was extraordinarily pure in many ways because they had not told anybody about what they had seen. And our book is called The Best Kept Secret for two reasons. The first one, as usual, is that, you know, the government came in and took everything and kept it secret until now. But the other reason is that the witnesses did the same thing. And that is unique in the, you know, in the archives of this phenomenon. Witnesses usually have a need to share what they've seen. I mean, it's a human thing. You want to communicate. You want to, but then you have to go back to the conditions at the time, 1945. The war wasn't completely over when this happened. There was Japan had only capitulated 2 days before, but there were still, you know, armies in the field and everything else. Most American men of fighting age were still in uniform. They had not been demobilized. And there was a sense that we were going from, you know, a shooting war to the Cold War that was going to last 20, 30 years. And secrets were kept. There was also the fact that the two little kids had sort of taken something that maybe they shouldn't have taken. And they had this secret, and they kept that secret very well until Paola found them.
We're going to take a brief break for our free Dreamlanders. When we come back, Paola is going to tell us a little bit about her meeting with them and what they were keeping secret. We'll be right back. Subscribers, don't miss the special in the subscriber specials section, which you can click through from the Dreamland show page after you log in. It's going to be about the entities and the fact that similar entities have been seen by other people, including me, in a particularly unusual event that suggests that none of this may be at all what it seems. Don't fail to listen to that material in the subscriber section. It is, believe me, going to be unique in this world. One reason to join UnknownCountry.com is the fact that you get Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, Majestic, and Superstorm audiobooks. Another reason, all of the subscriber interviews all the way back to the beginning, and some of them are totally remarkable. All of our contactee interviews that Ann Strieber did, deeply fascinating material. What is it really like to be inside this experience? If you're in it, you can learn more and more. And if you're not, then you can explore more and more. There is so much here. Join UnknownCountry.com today. Which means stop what you're doing, pause the show, go to UnknownCountry.com. Join now. Do it. We love you. And we'd really love you if you did it. As always, Dreamland's theme music is The O of Pleasure from Ray Lynch's beautiful album, Deep Breakfast, available at raylynch.com.
There are hundreds of charitable organizations in the world, but you have to have a sharp eye to be sure your money is going to where it's needed, and not into the pockets of overpaid administrators. That's why Whitley Strieber and UnknownCountry.com support the Mercy Corps. It's non-sectarian, it's lean and efficient, and it goes everywhere on earth that people are in need. When you contribute, you can be sure that most of your dollar goes right to the homeless, the starving, and the desperate. Go to Unknown Country and click on the Mercy Corps Foundation ad on the left side of your homepage. A $10 gift can put food on a child's plate and shoes on his feet. Unknown Country and Whitley Strieber receive no compensation from the Mercy Corps.
We're talking to Paola Harris and Jacques Vallee about their new book, Trinity, The Best Kept Secret. You can reach them on their websites, paolaharris.com and jacquesvallee.net. Both sites are filled with interesting material, and this book is remarkably well done, and as I would expect from the two of you, very solidly researched. Now, Paola, you had heard something about this enough to want to interview these two now elderly men about these childhood experiences. And what happened then?
Well, I found an opportunity to fly to Gig Harbor, Washington, and it's a good thing I did because, you know, if we don't get the witnesses right away, they pass on. And I flew to Washington State, met with Remy Baca. He was the 7-year-old. He was the younger of, and he told me all about what they had gone through. In other words, that they had seen a UFO that was not, by the way, Jacques and I will talk about this, was not a saucer. It was avocado shaped. It had come in. It had crashed against a part of a radio tower, and they had seen the whole crash landing, and it was intact when it did land. And then the two little boys, being as curious as they were and already in the field, took their binoculars, went down, and were able to stand in front of the panel that was missing, and were able to see what they call the little men or the creatures. And he's telling me this story, and then he puts me on the phone with a 9-year-old who is now living in California, and he's telling me the same story. Now, since that, we have a third witness, the cousin of Jose Padilla, who tells her part of the story that her cousin didn't even know about. And they all, you know what children are like. I mean, you remember the case in Africa with the kids. Kids have an incredible memory. They don't make things up. They're actually traumatized by things. And in those days, we must remember, in 1945, Kenneth Arnold had not coined the term flying saucer. These kids knew nothing about that. Roswell hadn't happened yet. So they're reliving, as Jacques said, a very pure, pure event. Right, so I got both testimonies. And then when Remy passed on, I went right away to the crash site with Jose, and I wanted to get there because I thought if one passes on and the other one does too, I'll never know where this happened. And, oh, my goodness, I've been to that site now at least 20 times.
You know, there will come a time when these sites are national monuments, I would think, but not now. Fortunately, they're still researchable, but only to a degree. When you were at the site at one point, there was an unusual, not an unknown plant, not an alien plant, I hasten to add, but an unusual situation involving a plant. Could you tell us a little bit about that, plant in
really
the circle?
Well, really quickly, because I'd like Jacques to fill in some more about the actual crash. But when I kept going down there, I told you, in fact, I'm on my way down there again. When I kept going down there, somebody was watching, I think, from somewhere. And on one occasion around 2014, what happened was that in that location, in that circle, very well-defined circle, what was planted was a toxic plant called cocklespur. And both Jacques, who took it to Stanford, and I, who sent it to the University of Colorado Botany Department, had it analyzed. And the anomaly is that it's not anywhere else on those 80,000 acres. We never saw that plant anywhere, and neither did Jose. He was very confused about it. And one of my assistants that tried to pull it up had an allergic reaction to it. We almost had to take him to the hospital. So I thought, this is getting weirder and weirder. Every time we come back to this site, there's different view of it. You know, somebody knows we're here. And I think might be beneficial, really, if Jacques explained the day of the crash to you, because there are so many things that happened.
It's a remarkable part of the book, Jacques. And yes, please do explain it. But before you do that, we're going to take another brief break for our free Dreamlanders. We'll be right back. Don't forget to listen, subscribers, to the subscriber special. I think it's probably quite important because I don't think there's anyone else in the world who could say the things that I say in it.
War Day changed the way we think about nuclear war. Communion led millions to realize that they had encountered the visitors. Superstorm gave a word to the world that has become the byword of our time. The Key is among the most prophetic books ever written. And where can you get inside the mind that created all this? On unknowncountry.com, where Whitley's life stories, his powerful meditations, his books, Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, and others are available in audio format, and so much more exclusive Whitley Strieber material. Join Whitley on the path to tomorrow. How? Subscribe to unknowncountry.com today.
We're talking to Jacques Vallee and Paola Harris about their book Trinity, The Best Kept Secret, one of the best books about a UFO crash I personally have ever read. And forget everything you're reading about it on Twitter or wherever. These are all things being published by people who didn't do it. And Jacques and Paola did this. Paola's website is paolaharris.com. Jacques is jacquesvallee.net. Jacques, it's time, I think, for you to fill in a little bit more about what we know about this crash.
Yes. And by the way, I'm not concerned about the people initially, before we the book was even out, people dismissing the whole case, because the case is extraordinary, and people are, you know, concerned that they, how come we never knew about it before? Well, they never knew about it before because the witnesses didn't speak. The witnesses were, we have to go back to that time of the end of the war, July and August 1945. These two kids, you know, why would these two kids be driving a truck? You know, the elder one is 9 years old. Why would they have binoculars? Why would they? I mean, those are not things that little kids do. Well, they do in time of war because the adults are out and they are all, fighting somewhere. And they're all in uniform, and the kids on the farm get the responsibility of watching the cattle and helping with chores. And the 9-year-old was driving the family truck. They were watching the cattle on that ranch, which, as you said, was 80,000 acres. The land was leased from BLM, the Bureau of Land Management. And they were very familiar with the territory. So they are there before the craft arrives. In this case, there are 10 elements of the sighting that are unique. The first one is that the witnesses were there before the object arrived, and they watched the whole thing. They watched the crash or the crash landing of this object. The object came after there had been a thunderstorm. The two kids had sought shelter. They were there because their father was concerned about a cow that was going to have a calf, and he wanted to make sure that that this was documented and that that they would put the brand and so on. So the kids were there with their horses. They had their binoculars. They did find the cow, and then they retired under a ledge, a rocky ledge, when the storm passed. And then this object arrived, and it arrived after hitting a tall tower. There were three major communications towers around the site where the bomb had been tested, the first atom bomb. And this particular tower was quite high and was designed to warn airplanes as they approached the high terrain to the north of there, where airplanes had accidents before. And the object hits the tower, bends part of one leg of the tower, and part of the panel on the object is ejected. But that's really the only, you know, an airplane would have been disintegrated at that point, would have fallen into pieces. The object kept its integrity, and then apparently still under power, came to the ground, dug up a trench, or essentially the equivalent of a trail of a road, straight down that long terrain, made a turn, and stopped against a berm, and the kids are watching all this. The bushes are burning. The object didn't burn. The object kept its integrity all the way down. There was, you know, the equivalent of a gouge in the earth, about 100 feet wide, that the kids were stunned in seeing that. But remember, this was the time of war, and people had been ingrained with the idea that if you're the first ones on the site of an accident, you have to immediately, you know, help the people who may be injured. So they rush down. Of course, they don't think of a UFO or anything like that. They think it's some sort of flying device. And
yeah, they would never have heard of that concept.
No, I mean, the word flying saucer was still 2 years in the future, you know, with, as Paola said, with the Kenneth Arnold sighting and Roswell and all of that was still 2 years away. But they had heard, of course, of accidents, of airplanes falling and so on. And they are, remember, they are within 20 miles of Ground Zero and Alamogordo Air Force Base and all of that. So they are very familiar with the war conditions. I can relate to that because I grew up in France during World War II. And, you know, there are things that as a kid that, you know, you get to learn when you're in the middle of a war, of a shooting war.
Yeah, I'm sure.
So they rush there. There is a lot of smoke. There is fire. The bushes are on fire. And it's hard to see exactly what's going on. They get to the site. They see an opening in the craft where that panel had been ejected when it hit the tower. I mean, all that is, we've reconstructed, and Paola had actually reconstructed the whole story, and I worked from her transcripts, going through them again and again and again. And there are a lot of things when you analyze the language, the words that they used and so on, and the tenses, times when they go from the past tense to the present. You know, we were there, we had left the horses, and we go there, and this is what we see, and we see the creatures, and they are moving, and they are crying, and so you see that, you feel in analyzing the transcripts like that you can see they are back there, that their memory has plunged them again into the reality of what happened at that particular moment, even though it's now 50 years or 60 years later. What they see through the opening is three small entities, creatures, that they call men, somewhat reluctantly, and you can tell they are not quite men. They are little men. They are about their size, about 3 feet, or 3.5 feet tall. So, you know, the size of the children. Except that they have large heads. The head is larger than the shoulders. The shoulders are narrow. They are long arms that come down to their knees. And they don't have five fingers. They have three or four fingers, depending on who is looking when. the creatures look a little like some insects, some crickets, for example. Some crickets look remarkably humanoid.
Yes, they do.
Pretty scary, but they are not scared. They think of them, they hear them sort of crying. They compare the crying to a rabbit when it, you know, when it's in pain or when you kill it. Again, they are growing on a farm. They know some of the facts of life, and they want to help them. They feel sorry for them. They are not scared. They feel sorry for them, but they know something is very wrong. And the elder one, Jose Padilla, wants to go and help. The younger one says, "No way, I'm not going there." And he's crying. Jose decides not to go there in deference to Remy. Because he knows that Remy can't take it, that is just too weird. And in the transcripts, you see them talking sometimes about the men, sometimes about the creatures. And when you pin them down to describe them, they describe essentially a large insect.
Now, was there any? They mentioned you. There's a mention of pictures being put into the heads of the boys.
So that's also an interesting discrepancy. When they, and as you know, I've been trained to look for that in transcripts of psychic impressions and that kind of thing. And sometimes they say, when Paola asks, "How long were you there?" They say, "Well, 15 minutes, 20 minutes. They were there for an hour or an hour and a half when you reconstruct the exact timing. Well, you know about kids.
Yes.
I met your kid, and I have two kids of my own. And 7-year-old and a 9-year-old are not going to stay still for an hour and a half.
No.
Under any conditions. They are mesmerized there. They are looking through the binoculars. They are passing the binoculars back and forth. So why would they have, a good set of binoculars? Well, they use the binoculars to read the brands on the cattle, okay? They have to every day make sure they keep an account of the cattle. The ranch is 80,000 acres, okay? These kids know the territory. They know how to use binoculars just as well as the army does. But then images come into their minds, images of other situations, images of things, people falling from buildings, images of things that are falling from the sky with sort of clouds and bursts of things, and they will have those dreams, both of them, for several years. The same dreams, and the same visions. They eventually, it's getting dark. They know their parents are concerned about them. They get on their horses and they go home in the night with Remy crying the whole way, and they don't know what they've seen. They describe it to their father, to Faustino Padilla, who says, "Well, listen, it's probably something with the military. We don't want you to get into trouble. We'll report it tomorrow, and we'll see, what the military wants to do about it."
Because understand, folks, that this happened in 1945, and it's very important to remember there was nothing about flying saucers in the world then, and there's no cultural reference at all. They literally could not imagine what they were seeing, but having lived certain things like this myself when I was a child, not quite like this. I can assure you that when something like that happens to a child, it is burned into their memory. Free Dreamlanders, we're going to take a little break, and when we get back, we're going to go a little deeper into that vehicle, why it crashed, and what it looked like on the inside. We'll be right back. I'd like to talk to you for a minute about the three books that I've written since Anne passed away. I think in many ways they are by far the three most important books I've ever written, at least in, to my mind. The Afterlife Revolution shows that there really is an afterlife, and I was privileged to have communication with my wife, with Anne, after she passed away, enacted by her in such a way that it was undeniable. The second book, A New World, is about communicating with the visitors, but in a real way. It's the only book of its kind in the world. There isn't another book like it, because quite frankly, there isn't anybody else who can do this like I can. I've been doing it for 30 years, or more than 30 years now, maybe for my whole life even. I think this is a unique book, I have to tell you. And the next one, Jesus, A New Vision, is also a vision of how we need to live if we're going to make contact work. It is totally outside of the context of war and weapons and so forth. It's about Jesus and living as he lived and he taught us for the good, on behalf of the good, and with the good in your heart, in your soul, in your blood, and your body. So if you have not read these three books, go to Amazon and get them and read them, or go to Audible and get them and listen to them. Bring them into your heart, because the three books together are a whole new way of looking at life, what it is, and where we are going. We're talking to Jacques Vallee and Paola Harris, their book, Trinity, The Best Kept Secret. Professor Paul Hynek, Alan Hynek's son, calls it groundbreaking research reveals a new UFO history, and it is extraordinary in this respect. It is also extraordinary in the respect of how it treats with such respect the witnesses and their memories stretching back to childhood, even though they are now in advanced adulthood, old age, in fact. Because Paola and Jacques understand something about the way intense memories survive. Now, what do you think, and either one of you answer this, or you can both answer it in your own way if you wish, what do you think brought it down? Why was it there?
One of the things I wanted to tell your listeners is that this is not a UFO book. This, for me, is a history book. Because the collaboration with Jacques Vallee was around the historical significance. It wasn't like this, whatever it was flying around, you know, on vacation somewhere. There was a specific time, a specific timeline, a specific purpose, and possibly a specific message. Since it came 1 month after we had exploded the atomic bomb 20 miles away in Ground Zero. And when Jacques and I collaborated, and may I encourage other people to collaborate on stories, I learned so very much. I had done the witness testimony, but he had done the basic research around the atomic bomb, Oppenheimer, Fermi, all the scientists that were there, and you have to look at this story in the context of when it happened, and you realize the significance. They never told the 70,000 people in San Antonio area. They were going to explode a bomb. So you start the whole story with Jose's mother opening the door and was blinded in one eye at 5 o'clock in the morning because the people didn't know. And so when this happens, there is an important significance to the event that's not just the UFO event. It is a history event because we had entered the nuclear age. And as you know, Whitley, you can't put the genie back in the bottle. You know, we had
there noticed.
Is that famous Trinity plaque going into Ground Zero that Jacques and I have seen so many times where Oppenheimer says from the Bhagavad Gita, "I am death, the destroyer of worlds," and the world's plural. So this was, I think, a dimensional event. So as far as going inside and what happened, you know, Jacques went into great detail scientifically, even looking at, you know, how many tons the craft was, because he went and researched the 18-wheeler that came in to take it out and so forth. So I'll let him go and describe now, Jacques, if you want to, the details. But I wanted to say, just from my point of view, this is a historical book more than a UFO book.
The book is a historical book. It's also, you know, it could be used as a, you know, as a model for how you research a case. There are so many cases, well, most cases are not researched. They, you know, people put it into what they call a database, and they throw it on the internet, and that's it. And then people do statistics based on that, which are, you know, probably pretty worthless. Some cases are researched because somebody makes a couple of phone calls, which is good. Some cases are researched because somebody goes there for a day or two and talks to the witnesses, which is even better. But to go into an area that, you know, I didn't grow up in New Mexico. I became familiar with New Mexico because Dr. Hynek at Northwestern University had an observatory there. So I actually joined Hynek there a couple of times and went to that observatory, and I had other occasions in my computer work to go to New Mexico, to go to Los Alamos and places like that. But I hadn't really become, you know, familiar with the culture to the point of understanding, especially the culture in 1945. And again, this is, you have to know that before you can understand what happened to the object or to the observation. When the army came to interview the father, Mr. Padilla, they spoke Spanish. I mean, of course they would speak Spanish. It's a Spanish-speaking area. It's a mix of different languages, English, Spanish, and various Indian native dialects. The area was populated by the Apache. On the cover of our book, there is a picture of Mama Grande, who was an Apache leader, who was, you know, the great grandmother of our main witness, Jose Padilla. And she's staring at you from the cover of our book. You know, these were the people who were there. And this was their culture. So we have to put it in that context of the end of a terrible, terrible war, detonation of, the test of the first atomic bomb that changed world history. And now you're telling me that this thing just happened to fall from the sky by mistake, that it just hit the tower and crashed? I don't think so. When you reconstruct everything that happened at that time, it looks to me more like a signal, that you could not ignore. A donation, as someone said, of something with a technology that, and we can go, as you said, more into, how it was inside and so on, because this is a case where three people just walked inside a UFO and had a good chance to look at what was there.
Can you describe what they saw?
The first people who went in were the father, Mr. Padilla, Faustino Padilla, led to the site by the kids. So the kids are driving the truck, and the father is with an officer, with a state officer that was a friend of the family, that he called to report the case. Again, thinking that this was probably something that the army should know about, and it was probably an army craft that had landed there. So they go there, led by the kids. They have trouble finding it because, in the meantime, somebody has been hiding the craft. We think that somebody was the pilot of an airplane, of a bomber that was coming back to Alamogordo, who saw the thing and actually saw the two kids and reported that and went back the next day because he was the first one to be available to go to the site. So there's one day when the kids were not on the site, and then they go there with their father and with the officer. The creatures are no longer there. The kids have trouble finding the thing because the pilot, the Army Air Force, remember there was no Air Force. I mean, the Air Force was a unit that was attached to the Army. There wouldn't be an Air Force for another 2 years. And the craft has been covered with vegetation, and there has been some cleaning done, and the beings, the entities, are no longer there. We don't know where they went, or if they were taken away by, by the Army Air Force unit that came there the first day. There is no military presence when the father gets there. They do discover the object hidden by the vegetation that was thrown around it. They go inside. They tell the kids to stay out. The two men go inside. When they come back, in the Remy testimony, there is something changed in their behavior. They are very serious. They are very somber. They sit the kids down and they say, look, we don't want you to get into trouble. This is, way beyond, anything. You don't talk about it. You don't talk about it to your friends. You don't talk about it to anybody else. We're going to take care of it. And they evidently have realized that this was no airplane and no device that was built by men, in 1945. They've been there a while. They come out, not carrying anything from the inside, and everybody goes home. The kids get on their horses and they come back. When you ask them, why did you do that? They say, that was our duty. We had to check the fences. We had to check the cattle. Don't you realize we had a big job to do and so on? Well, those two kids are curious. They want to go back to see what it is. And in fact, with their horses, it only takes half an hour to get there on horseback. Right. With a car, you have to go around the roads and so on, and the roads are not very practicable. It's complicated to walk some of the way and so on. So the kids are way ahead of the game, and they come back, and again they look at it. The army then arrives with just a jeep, and they start looking at how they're going to clean up the site. The site is littered with little pieces of stuff that has fallen off from where the panel used to be. And the kids are hiding in the bushes, and the kids are going to watch this for the next 8 days. Okay? So we've reconstructed every day. We've reconstructed, we have a table in the book about, you know, when it rained and what the temperature was and all the conditions. We've done that pretty carefully because, again, we have the opportunity to look at a case where we have witnesses on site day by day, hour by hour, minute by minute. And we can account for everything that the Army has done because they were watching, carefully. So that's what we have. The Army, then an officer comes to the home of the Padillas, speaking Spanish again, and says, we need your permission to cut your fence. And the father says, you know, there's a cattle gate, you know, why don't you use that? I mean, a jeep can go through that. I mean, it's no problem. And they say, well, you know, we need to retrieve this large weather balloon, and so we need to bring a truck and maybe a crane, and we need to dig our own road. So we want to, but, you know, don't worry, we'll put a nice gate, on the new fence, and you'll have a new road on your property. So he has to let them do that. After all, it's the army, but that's also his land. So they take a couple of days to do that. They need to bring a grader to build a road, and then they bring in an 18-wheeler. And this is where I had a little argument with Paola. And I say we need to ask Mr. Padilla what kind of a truck it was, and she says, well, why do you care about the truck? And well, I need to know how many wheels are on the truck, because we need to know how much this thing weighs, this weather balloon. And we don't have an exact weight, of course, but from the way they erected the crane and they lifted this thing, which, by the way, the kids tried to move and they couldn't budge it. It was probably...
Must have been designed for heavy weather.
Couple of trucks. It was probably between 5 and 10 tons, and it was loaded on a lowboy drawn by a tractor, of this 18-wheeler, which explains why they had a special gate and a special road.
You know, these things are so heavy, Jacques. I remember in one of your books, you talked about analyzing the prints that one of them had made with three, when it came down with three legs, and you came to understand how heavy it actually was. And yet when we see them flying around in the recent videos, it's breathtaking. Do you have any ideas as to what they might be?
Well, the book of course is about this case, but remember, I'm approaching this, not so much as a physicist. I know what my physics readers are going to want to know. They want to know about the 18-wheeler, never mind the psychic stuff. And we're giving them, everything we can about the physics. But I'm basically, an information scientist, so I'm looking for patterns. And in the book, we draw a parallel between this case, the Socorro case, which is a case you're thinking of, Whitley.
Yeah, that's right, it is.
Where the imprints were measured. Remember, Dr. Hynek was there, the Air Force was there, the FBI was there, and the police was there, and all with different agendas. And we actually, in the book, we reveal certain things that people have never known about the Socorro case because they were not published at the time. And then the case in Valençal in France, where those are cases that I followed carefully, cases that are official cases. I mean, the investigation was carried on by the police in case in France, the gendarmes and French intelligence and the French Air Force. And we have all those reports. So in all three cases, there was no flying saucer. The objects were egg-shaped or avocado-shaped. We know their dimensions. They had the same kind of propulsion and the same kinds of entities or beings, little men who breathed our air. They breathed, you know, the same atmosphere that we do. They didn't have a helmet on. They didn't have a breathing apparatus on. They didn't look like astronauts on the moon. And in all three cases, traces were left. And yes, you're right. Those traces, especially in Socorro, where the traces were well preserved, they were preserved by the police and then by Dr. Hynek. And, you know, you're talking about tons, a number of tons. Say, the weight of two, if you take a Ford F-150, you take two of them together, that's about the weight, okay? And that's about the carrying capacity of those things. And in Socorro, there was a blast of light underneath, which was not rocket light. It was more like laser light or, just a beam of light, and the thing lifted with a terrific, you know, thunder sound, went up to about 60 feet, and just started hanging there silently. And then it started gliding in a direction that would take it, by the way, over White Sands. And we've reconstructed all that now for the first time in this book. So we draw the parallel again. We're looking for patterns. No one case is going to convince the academy. I mean, that has been drilled into me by colleagues at Stanford, by colleagues and by people in the Air Force, by people on the Bigelow, you know, advisory board and so on. No one case will carry the weight of the evidence. You need to build patterns, and that's what I'm trying to do here. That was my contribution, starting from the outstanding transcripts that I had from Paola and from Paola showing me the site and introducing me to the witnesses.
So now let's move on a little bit, talking about the memory medal and the eventual fate of the little piece of it they found. But before that, I want you to give us an idea of the human history of this medal, which is always seen in the UFO literature as such a mystery. It isn't actually a mystery, is it?
Well, we have memory medals now for aerospace, for actuators, and in some other areas. I mean, strange metals with special features that are used in surgery, that are very, very sophisticated. And but in those days, there was no such thing. And the memory medal has been mentioned about Roswell. And by the way, this case enables us to understand more about Roswell. It's not at all in competition with Roswell. You know, there are things in Roswell that make us understand this case, and there are things in this case that throw light on Roswell. Roswell is 1947. In 1947, yes, there were research institutions like Battelle in Ohio that has done a lot of work on metallurgy and a lot of work on UFOs, and arguably maybe still does, that were very interested in memory metal, and metal that you could bend and you could even make a ball out of it, and it would stretch when you left it, and it would retain its initial form. It would go flat as if nothing had happened. Obviously, it can be used in machinery. It can be used in actuators. It can be used in a number of moving parts as a very useful material to have.
But the
in
oh,
1945, it's hard to believe that anybody would have manufactured it on Earth. We can't find a trace of any patent bearing on that kind of thing. People were certainly searching, special alloys for ammunition and for aircraft, but we haven't, maybe somebody will come up with new information about that after reading our book, and we'd certainly love to pursue that. But as far as we know today from the research we've done, there was nothing like that. There are three other types of metals that the kids describe that not only had strange properties, but they were a little bit dangerous to handle.
And in the third half hour, we're going to get into the remarkable story of this metal and some of this metal and how it was used. So keep your hats on, folks. You won't often have heard. In fact, I'll rephrase that. You will never have heard anything quite like this. We're talking to Jacques Vallee and Paola Harris. Their new book, Trinity, The Best Kept Secret. Paola's website is paolaharris.com. Jacques' website is jacquesvallee.net. Free Dreamlanders, thank you so much for spending time with us. And as always, I urge you to subscribe to unknowncountry.com. You can't get this, not in this way, anywhere else in the world.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host, and I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.